This episode is sponsored by Brilliant. Hi guys, Jade here. So a few weeks ago I made a video on the Schrodinger equation, and in it I said that if we place an electron in a box, the probability that it could be found outside the box is zero. And a lot of you commented with questions like, oh, but what about quantum tunneling? Isn't there some cases where the electron can tunnel outside of the box? So I thought, what the heck, I'll just make a whole video about it. It's super cool, and I will answer that specific question at the end of the video. But first, what is quantum tunneling? Well, the short version is, in regular classical physics, if you have a ball at the bottom of a hill, if it doesn't get a big enough push to get over the hill, it's kind of just stuck there. Putting this into physics talk, if the ball doesn't have enough kinetic energy to get over the potential energy of the hill, it'll never get over. Like, ever. But of course, in quantum mechanics, things aren't so simple. If we replace the ball with a quantum particle like an electron, and the hill with some kind of potential barrier, even if the electron doesn't have enough kinetic energy to jump the potential barrier, sometimes it can end up on the other side. This is called quantum tunneling, and in this video, we're going to see how it works. So now, the long version. So one of the biggest differences between quantum and classical physics is that quantum physics is probabilistic. Unlike a ball, we can't pinpoint exactly where an electron is. This comes from the Heisenberg uncertainty principle, which says that we can never know the exact position and momentum of an object. It's not because our measuring devices are too crappy or because we're too slow, it's just something fundamental about the laws of nature. But not all hope is lost. Maybe we don't know exactly where the electron is, but we know with a pretty high probability that it's around here somewhere. We can actually model these probabilities with a wave, or more technically, a wave function. This wavy cloud gives us the probabilities of where the electron is likely to be. So now, instead of imagining a particle traveling toward a barrier, imagine a wave traveling toward a barrier. Now, when this wave collides with the barrier, because the electron doesn't have enough kinetic energy to make it over, it gets reflected. But wait, what about the whole tunneling thing? Well, there's this secret property of waves you probably didn't learn in school. Light is an electromagnetic wave, so let's imagine what happens when we shine a light beam through glass. When we shine a light beam through a piece of glass, at the boundary where the glass meets the air, the light beam will bend, or refract. You may have noticed this effect if you've ever looked at a straw in your water glass. The visual illusion comes from the bending of light at the boundary of two different mediums. In this case, air and water. But refraction isn't the only thing that can happen at a boundary. Light can also get reflected. The amount of light which is reflected and refracted depends on the angle that the light hits the boundary. All mediums have a certain angle where 100% of the light beam is reflected. This is called total internal reflection, and you may have heard that when this happens, 100% of the incident beam goes back into the reflected beam. But that's not true. These are Maxwell's equations, and though they may look innocent, they form the entire foundation of classical electromagnetism. Remember how we said that light is an electromagnetic wave? This means that the way light behaves in different scenarios can be predicted and modeled by solving Maxwell's equations. Now, when we solve these equations for the case of total internal reflection, we get something very interesting. This. Isn't that interesting? Instead of there being an abrupt drop-off where the light hits the boundary, there's this very quick exponential drop-off. This is shown by this term here. I know this looks super complicated and, well, it is. So let's just get rid of all that mumbo-jumbo here and just focus on the bit that matters. This is a graph of e to the power x, which, as you can see, models exponential growth. But the term in our equation is e to the power negative x, which is simply the backwards version of this, exponential decay. So we have this tiny little drop-off wave here. This is called an evanescent wave, which, in my opinion, is a very suitable name. The word evanescent means soon passing out of sight, memory, or existence, quickly fading or disappearing. An evanescent wave is pretty much exactly what it sounds like. It decays incredibly quickly, lasting only a few wavelengths before vanishing, so we can't usually see or detect it. But if we place another material sufficiently close to the boundary of the first, sometimes the evanescent wave doesn't decay completely to zero before hitting the next material. so it can then continue to travel onwards. This is called frustrated total internal reflection, and I recommend looking up a demo on YouTube after this. I would have shown you in this video, but for anyone who's read my Twitter bio, you know that experiments are not my forte. I actually did try it, and it just didn't work. Mild digression. Optics was one of my favorite subjects in university, and we did a lot of work on evanescent waves, but I never really got a physical intuition for why they're there. The only answer I ever found is because Maxwell's equations say so, like when you solve the equations, you end up with this decaying exponential. But other than that, I can't really see a physical reason for why a wave can't just abruptly stop at a boundary and change direction. So if you do, please explain it to me in the comments. Okay, digression over. This wave might be puny, but it's the reason behind why quantum tunneling is possible. Remember that we're treating our electron as a probability wave, which means that when it gets reflected here, an evanescent wave forms at the boundary. If the barrier is thin enough, sometimes some of the wave actually makes it through. So if some of the wave makes it through, and this wave represents the probability of the location of the electron, then there's some very small but non-zero probability that our electron is over here. Even though this probability is tiny, because there are usually so many quantum particles involved in any physical process, the effects of quantum tunneling are large enough to be essential to nuclear fusion in stars, spontaneous mutation in DNA, and scanning tunneling microscopy. It may seem startling that we're treating the wave function exactly like an electromagnetic wave. It's hard to imagine something so abstract like the probabilities of electron locations as a real physical thing that travels and reflects and tunnels. The truth is, scientists still don't know exactly what a wave function is. They don't know whether it's purely a mathematical tool we've created to help us predict things about quantum objects, or whether it's a real physical wave. But what they do know is that it can be modeled pretty much perfectly by wave mechanics. When we solve the Schrödinger wave equation for the electron inside the barrier, we get this exponential decay, which is exactly what we would expect of an evanescent wave. Speaking of Schrödinger's equation, in my video about that I said, if we place an electron in a box, the probability that it could be found outside the box is zero. And a lot of you are confused because what about tunneling? Well, the truth is, I didn't specify this very well. In a lot of university degrees, a particle in a box is the simplest case we use to analyze Schrödinger's equation, but it's actually a particle in an infinite potential well. So instead of this being a box, look at it as a well with infinitely high and thick walls. In tunneling, the barrier needs to be thin enough so that the evanescent wave doesn't have time to completely decay to zero before reaching the other side. Only then can it propagate onwards. With infinitely high and thick walls, that's obviously impossible. So yeah, my bad, didn't specify infinity. In my last video, someone commented asking whether it was futile to try and truly understand quantum mechanics without doing the math. And my immediate reaction was, yes. While you can learn the catchphrases and get an overall gist of what's going on, to really get that gut feeling of understanding and intuition, you need to work through the problems and see what the equations tell you. I didn't really understand the Schrödinger equation until I solved it myself. Brilliant.org is a learning website with an entire course dedicated to quantum mechanics. It starts with the very first experiments which reveal strange quantum behavior and takes you all the way to Schrödinger's equation. It has this interactive quiz style, which I love because you can work through problems at your own pace and check your understanding at every step. I actually just worked through these quizzes on the mathematical foundations of quantum physics and had a few of my own aha moments, as some questions I'd had since university were finally answered. There are also tons of other courses specializing in math, physics, and computer science. Brilliant is offering a 20% discount to the first 200 people to sign up using this link. Just go to brilliant.org/upandatom and start learning quantum physics today. Thanks for watching, guys. I hope you enjoyed the video. It was actually the result of a poll I posted on the YouTube community tab. So if you would like to be included in those polls and vote on your favorite topics, then just click the notification bell. This video is also part of a quantum physics series I've got going on at the moment, which I've linked for you at the end of the video and in the description. So until next time, bye!